वेलकम स्टूडेंट्स एंड द टॉपिक ट्रांसपोर्टेशन इन ह्यूमन बीइंग्स। ट्रांसपोर्टेशन मीन्स मूवमेंट ऑफ सब्सटेंसेस इनसाइड द ह्यूमन बॉडीज। फॉर एग्जांपल ट्रांसपोर्टेशन ऑफ गैसेस ऑक्सीजन कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड, ट्रांसपोर्टेशन ऑफ हार्मोन्स, ट्रांसपोर्टेशन ऑफ डाइजेस्टेड फूड पार्टिकल्स। How this process takes place inside the body, about that we will study in this topic. The main transport system in human beings is the circulatory system. It consists of blood, arteries, veins, capillaries and heart. Arteries, veins and capillaries, these three are named as blood vessels, tubular structures which carry blood inside them, and heart is the pumping organ. With the help of heart, blood is transported throughout the body, inside arteries, inside veins and inside capillaries, and blood reaches to each and every cell of the body. And likewise, with the help of heart only, blood again comes back to the heart through veins and bringing back waste materials in liquid form, soluble solid form and gaseous waste also. So about all those we will study in this topic. Now what is blood? As you have learned in class 9, blood is a type of specialized connective tissue in which matrix is in fluid form. Liquid matrix is there in class 9, you have studied. And it is a mixture also. It has different types of blood cells in it and some other substances, some amount of water also. Blood helps in transportation of food, oxygen, waste products, and it consists of plasma. Plasma means the fluid matrix of blood, that is water actually. Red blood cells, RBC, white blood cells, WBC and platelets. Some more substances are also present in blood. In higher classes you will study about them. Plasma transports food, water, carbon dioxide, nitrogenous waste. Red blood cell transports oxygen. White blood cell kills harmful microbes and protects the body. Platelets help in clotting of blood and prevent loss of blood during injury. Now in detail. As I told that in our blood about 70-75% water is present, which is named here blood plasma. And blood plasma helps to transfer food, digested food particles which are soluble in water, as well water also, carbon dioxide, nitrogenous waste also from heart to the cells and again from cells to the heart. You must have learned in respiration topic that glucose, the end product of digested carbohydrate, is soluble in water, so it dissolves in water, blood plasma, and is transported from small intestine to different cells of our body. Likewise, oxygen is taken by the blood. You have learnt in respiration topic, which is also comparatively lesser soluble than carbon dioxide. So oxygen is transported from lungs to different cells with the help of red blood cells. Later on I will discuss. But carbon dioxide is comparatively more soluble, so it is in dissolved form transported from different cells to the lungs as the gaseous waste. Likewise, after filtration of blood through the kidneys, nitrogenous waste are formed and are urinated by the body. So these nitrogenous waste which are formed inside the cells are again carried by blood plasma in dissolved form from different cells to the heart, and from heart again to the pass to the kidney for filtration. Red blood cells are red in color and made up of different types of cells. You have learnt in class 9, erythrocytes mainly, and it contains red color pigments named as hemoglobin. Hemoglobin is a type of nitrogenous compound, protein you can say. Oxygen has affinity to combine with hemoglobin, and oxygen combines with hemoglobin particles to form oxyhemoglobin. So in the form of oxyhemoglobin, oxygen is transported from alveoli of the lungs to different cells of the body. Whereas white blood cells kills harmful microbes present in the blood, as well as it protects the body from infection. Actually, a word which we are discussed earlier in lower classes, in class 8, 9, immunity, that immunity is maintained with the help of white blood cells. So white blood cells protects us from infections. White blood cells engulf the harmful microbes and help the body to remain disease free. Now the third cell type, platelets, are also present in blood which help in clotting of blood. Platelets has a type of protein compound named as thrombin which helps in clotting of blood, and in such a way it prevents loss of blood during injury. Now about the functioning of different types of vessels. Arteries are present beneath the muscles of the body, and arteries look red in color, and arteries carry pure blood, you can say oxygenated blood, means blood with oxygen, maximum amount of oxygen, richly supplied with oxygen, which is named as oxygenated blood, from the heart to all parts of the body. Because blood carries oxygen with it, and heart is present in chest region, in chest cavity, so the flow of blood in arteries is high, pressure of blood is high through the arteries, so it is thick wall, and it does not have any valves, because downward movement of blood is going through the arteries, so no need of valves. So arteries are thick walled, arteries have no valves, and arteries have high blood pressure, and these are present beneath our muscles, and arteries carry oxygenated blood from heart to all parts of the body, means all cells of the body. And arteries look red in color. Now about the veins. Veins carry impure blood, can say blood with nitrogenous waste, excess water and carbon dioxide with it, that is named as carboxygenated blood, or here it is written as impure blood, from all cells or all parts of the body to the heart. Upward movement of blood takes place through the veins, so it has comparatively low blood pressure. I think you are aware with the blood pressure term, 120/80 mmHg, it is normal for a normal healthy adult person. 120, that is the movement of blood through the arteries, and 80 mmHg, that is movement of blood through the veins. So comparatively veins have low blood pressure. Veins can be seen green colored. Tubular structure can be observed just below our skin, and they are thin walled because low blood pressure they have, and they have valves because upward movement happens through the blood, so it needs valves. Now about the question may come here, differences between arteries and veins. So you may write, differences are, arteries carry oxygenated blood from heart to all the parts of the body, whereas veins carry carboxygenated blood from all parts of the body to the heart. Now the second difference, arteries have high blood pressure and veins have low blood pressure. Arteries are thick walled, whereas veins are thin walled. Arteries do not have any valves, but veins have valves. These are the differences. Question may come. Now about the third vessel, that is capillaries. These are found at the junction of arteries and veins near a cell. Because diameter of arteries and veins are much bigger than that of the diameter of one individual cell. So it is needed there very fine tubular structure, that are capillaries. These are very narrow blood vessels which connects arteries and veins together. The exchange of food, water, oxygen, carbon dioxide, etc. between the blood and the cells takes place through the capillaries. Whatever substances arteries carry that are given to the capillaries, and capillaries send them to the cells. And whatever waste products are formed inside the cell, that are again taken by the capillaries and then transported to the veins, and through the veins these are transported to the heart and so on. So capillaries are also very important. Now the pumping organ, our heart, we will study about it. You may observe diagram on the screen. Heart is a muscular organ which pumps blood in all parts of the body. I can cite you example, as at your home you are seeing an electric pump which pumps water and sends to through the tubes to all the parts wherever it is required in our house. Likewise, heart is also a pumping organ made up of, you are knowing well, cardiac muscles. Cardiac muscles which have continuous rhythmic contraction and expansion and pumps blood to all parts of the body. Human heart is four chambered. The upper chambers are called atria. Atria is a plural word. One individual is known as atrium or auricle. And the lower chambers are called ventricles. Since the ventricles pump blood to the different organs, so its walls are thicker than the atria. You are observing the diagram. The upper parts are atrium, thin wall comparatively, but the lower part, ventricles, are thick walled. The right and left chambers are separated by septum, the middle wall like structure you are observing. It prevents the mixing of oxygenated and deoxygenated blood. Deoxygenated blood means in which there is very lesser amount of oxygen, more amount of carbon dioxide. And oxygenated blood means oxygen rich blood. So left atrium and left ventricle has oxygenated blood, whereas right atrium and right ventricle has deoxygenated blood, and septum divides the two parts so that there will be no mixing. Because why it is necessary? Question rises here. Because we are a warm blooded animal, we need continuous supply of energy to keep our body warm. Continuously heat is transferred into the environment through the body. Loss of energy through the body continuous it is happening. As well, for different body function also we have great need of energy. So we need more amount of energy in comparison to the smaller organism and cold-blooded organism. That's why we need rapid rate of transportation of oxygen, so that the left part of the heart is separated by the septum to right part of the heart, so that there will be no mixing of oxygenated and deoxygenated blood, so that continuous and rapid process can be possible for the transportation of oxygen, so that energy can be regained by the body continuously. Here two different valve-like structures are also present. One valve-like structure that is known as bicuspid valve between the left atrium to left auricle, so that there will be no backward flow of blood from ventricle to the atrium. You are observing there. Likewise, tricuspid valve is present in at the junction point of right atrium and right ventricle. Here also, again, to avoid the backward flow of the blood into the atrium, these valves are helping. You may observe diagrams. Comparatively, the organisms which have smaller body structure, for example, birds are also warm-blooded animal, but they have only three chambered heart. I have explained it earlier that because they have a small body structure, so they need comparatively less amount of energy, so that can be possible even by mixing of deoxygenated and oxygenated blood in the heart, and they have three chambered heart only, but we have four chambered heart. And some bigger size cold blooded animals also have three chambered and four chambered heart also. You may crocodile, alligators, this type of animals also have, even though they are cold-blooded animals. Cold-blooded animals means they do not give energy. Energy is not dissipated from the body to the environment through these animals. But they have lesser tolerance according to environment. We can tolerate better. So organisms are divided into cold-blooded animal and warm-blooded animal. You have learnt in class 9, I think, classification, diversity chapter, biodiversity chapter. Now, You may observe diagram of heart, how circulation takes place. You are observing here mechanism of circulation. Blood is taken through pulmonary vein from lungs to the left atrium of the heart. Then it is passed to the left ventricle, and from the ventricle through the pulmonary, aorta. Through aorta it is sent to the arteries, and arteries then divides to capillaries and to the cells. Working of the heart diagram you are observing. Now we will try to understand the working of heart. When the left atrium releases oxygenated blood from the lungs, flows into it through the pulmonary vein. When it contracts, the left ventricle expands and the blood flows into it. Then the left ventricle again contracts and the oxygenated blood is pumped out through the aorta to all parts of the body through the arteries. After circulating through all parts of the body, the deoxygenated blood from all the cells enters to the right atrium through the vena cava. Vena cava is joined with the number of veins. Blood flows into right atrium. Then the right ventricle contracts and the blood is pumped into the lungs through the pulmonary artery, and in the lungs carbon dioxide is removed and oxygen is absorbed, and then again oxygenated blood enters the left atrium and the process repeats. Again I am explaining. You are observing the red part of the heart, which is joined to the lungs. Two different tubular structure are joined to the lungs, that is named as pulmonary vein. Through the pulmonary veins, oxygenated blood is transported to left atrium. From the left atrium, it is transported to left ventricle by the continuous contraction and relaxation of the heart. And from the left ventricle, it is transported with the help of aorta to different arteries, and arteries sends them to the capillaries, and through the capillary to different cells. Again, from different cells, the deoxygenated blood is transported to first capillaries, from the capillaries to different veins, from the veins to the pulmonary artery, vena cava, and from vena cava it is transported to the right atrium of the heart, blue part of the heart you are observing on the screen, and from right atrium to the right ventricle, and from the right ventricle again through pulmonary artery, deoxygenated blood, means blood with carbon dioxide, is transported to both the lungs, and lungs, inside the lungs, carbon dioxide molecules are taken with the help of diffusion process through the alveoli, and again oxygen particles are passed into the blood, and the same process repeats. Now about the limb. Since blood flows through the heart twice in 1 cycle, so the circulation process in human is known as double circulation. Because once blood is flown from lungs to the heart, and again from heart it is flown to the different parts of the body, and from different parts again to the heart, and from heart to the lungs again. So two times the process is happening, so it is named as double circulation. Lymph is a colorless fluid present in intercellular spaces. It is formed from the plasma the same blood plasma, but which escapes from the capillaries into the intercellular spaces, but lymph drains into lymphatic capillaries, which forms lymph vessels and joins into large veins. Lymph transports digested fat and drains excess fluids from intercellular spaces back into the blood. It contains lymphocytes, which kills germs and protects the body. It doesn't have hemoglobin, so it looks pale white. Sometimes you must have seen, if you have some injury, so pus we are calling it in common language, that is made up of lymph. Hearts of mammals, birds and amphibians, reptiles and fishes. About some more animals we have to study here. The heart in mammals and birds have in general four chambered heart, and the right and left sides of the heart is separated by a septum. Earlier I had taught you, this prevents mixing of oxygenated and deoxygenated blood and provides efficient supply of oxygen. I discussed it. This is necessary because we need more amount of energy as we are warm-blooded animal. We maintain our body temperature. Now the heart in amphibians and reptiles, they may have three-chambered or two-chambered heart and allows some mixing of deoxygenated and oxygenated blood because they do not need much amount of energy in comparison to mammals and birds to maintain their body temperature. The body temperature is the same as the temperature of the surrounding. Now the heart in fishes, diagrams are given here. Fishes have only two chambered heart and blood is oxygenated in the gills only. Now transportation in plants. As you know that there is no blood like anything inside the plant body, but important materials, required materials are also transported throughout the plant parts with the help of water. In plants, transportation of molecules like food, water, minerals takes place through conducting tissues called xylem and phloem. I think you are well familiar with these two words, xylem and phloem. These are specialized tissues in plants, transporting tissue, vascular bundles names are also given somewhere in the books. Xylems transport water and minerals from the roots to all parts of the plant, and it consists of four different types of cells: xylem vessels, xylem tracheid, xylem parenchyma and xylem fiber. Xylem vessels and xylem tracheids frame tubular structure for transportation of water and minerals, whereas xylem parenchyma and xylem fibers provides a strength mechanical support to the tissue. Water and minerals enter the roots by diffusion, you have learned earlier, and then due to transpiration, the suction force helps in the upward movement of water and minerals in a higher plants. You are observing different sized plants in the nature. Some are small. If the plant is smaller in size, then root pressure is sufficient for transportation of water and minerals from soil to the different parts of the plant. But if the plant has huge body like a banyan tree, a mango tree, neem tree likewise, which are much higher, much longer, much higher, taller, then with the root pressure is not sufficient to transport water and minerals from root to the all parts of the plant. Then it needs some additional support, and that pressure is known as suction pull or suction pressure, where transpiration process helps to transport the water and minerals. That's why you are observing during the daytime such type of plants suck more amount of water. As higher the rate of transpiration through the leaves, greater will be the rate of absorption of water and minerals through the roots in higher plants. So in higher plants, root pressure as well as suction pressure both help to transportation of water and minerals from soil to the tip of the plant to different parts. Now about the phloem. Phloem is also a specialized tissue. It has also four different types of cells. Diagram you are observing here. Hana. Xylem transports food from the leaves to other parts. Not only leaves. If the plant is young, its stems are also green. So greeny part wherever in the plant body that does photosynthesis. So from such part to the different cells of the plant, different parts of the plant. So phloem helps in that. Phloem also has four different types of cells: sieve tube, companion cell, phloem parenchyma, phloem fiber. So sieve tubes and companion cells consist, which helps tubular structure for transportation of food synthesized in the greeny part of the plant, and food from the leaves is transported to the xylem through the phloem by the energy of ATP molecules. Here energy is required, but in transportation of water and minerals no energy is required. And due to osmotic pressure, water enters the phloem and helps in the transportation of blood. Diagram is given here. I think you are well familiar with such diagrams. You have learned earlier in class 9 about this. Now, the next topic is excretion, which we will study next day. Thank you.